Hello friends, assalamu alaikum. This is Eman Arif from the platform of Synth Biotechnologist Association, SBA, and the topic which we are going to discuss today is polymerase chain reaction or PCR. This is the agenda of our today's session in which we'll discuss everything about PCR along with its market trends. So, what is PCR? Have you ever heard of something like photocopier? Yes, you heard it right. It's the same technique like a photocopier. PCR is an in vitro technique to make many copies of DNA or RNA. What does it mean that we can actually amplify the pieces of DNA or RNA within the lab facilities, which is known as in vitro technique? And the enzyme which is going to help us in this particular process is TAC polymerase. Why this enzyme is called TAC polymerase is because it is isolated from the hot sulfur springs, and it is the short form or abbreviation of Thermus aquaticus. So, where it all started from? This all started from the year 1983, where a chemist, Carey Mullis, was working with a biotech corporation known as Cetus Corporation. And while working for them, an idea generated in his mind of doing a polymerase chain reaction. By the end of 1985, October, he actually and officially introduced this technique and thus rewarded with $10,000 for this innovation. Later on, in 1993, Carey Mullis, along with his co-partner, Michael Smith, was awarded Nobel Prize Award in chemistry. So, these are some basic and major types of PCR. However, there are many, but we'll discuss some of them. So let's start with the conventional PCR. Conventional PCR technique is used to amplify and detect different sequences of DNA. Why it is used and most commonly used is because that it's very cost effective. It is easiest PCR to perform, yet it requires a lot of human efforts. That's why real-time PCR is more appropriate and is chosen over conventional PCR. Real-time PCR can give us the results in real time. That means we can get the results in the minimum time, but it is not cost effective. It is expensive than conventional PCR, but it is highly specific because it uses the probe technology, which assures its selection and amplification of the specific region. However, in multiplex PCR, we can use a single tube to amplify many copies and many alleles of a gene. In nested PCR, two sets of the reactions are used. It is used for the amplification and detection of DNA using external and internal primer set in sequential steps. It is more sensitive and it decreases the ability of non-specific amplification. However, it sometimes produces false positive results because of the carryover contamination, which means that during handling or PCR setup, we actually come across with the contamination of reagents or also sample. In reverse transcriptase PCR, mRNA is particularly used to make the complementary DNA strand, which is then amplified into the DNA. RNA is highly likely sensitive to degradation. That's why added reverse transcriptase step may increase time and cost as well as potential for contamination. This whole chart has been taken from the United States Environmental Protection Agency, EPA. So now let's come over the prerequisites of a PCR. That what do we need to run a PCR? We need certain things in which DNA template, the DNA which we want to amplify and which we want to copy is needed, along with oligonucleotide primers. Primers are the short oligonucleotide stretches that are known to the reaction. Also, the enzyme tag polymerase has been used. Deoxynucleotide triphosphate, DNTPs, are used for the extension of the template RNA. Buffer solutions and divalent cations are also used, basically containing magnesium cofactor, which is a divalent cation. The whole process of thermal cycling involves three basic steps, which is denaturation, annealing, and extension. Denaturation of the double-stranded DNA, annealing of primers, and extension of that particular double-stranded DNA molecules. So this slide shows the different stages of PCR. The first and foremost is denaturation. You can see the two strands of a DNA. In denaturation, the bonds, hydrogen bonds between these two strands are broken down, and the highest temperature is required to break these bonds. Now, since we need to break these bonds, this is basically dependent upon the GC content, which means guanine to cytosine ratio. This usually takes place at 94 to 96 degrees Celsius. Then we have two strands of DNA. Then in annealing step, the primers got attached with the single-stranded DNA. And then in elongation or extension step, these primers move towards the 3' terminal and extend these templates to make its copies. Elongation takes place usually between usually at 70 to 75 degrees Celsius. This whole cycle involves approximately 40 to 45 cycles. Now, whenever we run a PCR, we usually got confused with its interpretation of the results. So when we run conventional PCR, we need to run agarose gel electrophoresis to read it. For that, we need a gel, which is usually 1 to 2% of agarose, and then we make wells to pour our samples. A DNA ladder or molecular marker is being also placed inside the well to identify the size of our concerned DNA. For example, you can see in the lane ABC, there are many bands over there, just like these, which I am highlighting to you. So if I talk about the C lane or C sample, you can see that this band corresponds to almost 600 base pair. So we can say that our DNA is actually 600 base pair in size. If it lies between two bands of molecular marker, we will say that it's between 550 or 570 base pair long. However, when we run the real-time PCR, we have the results in the graphical format, which you can see over here. This graph involves different phases. The first phase is exponential phase, which shows the highest multiplication of a DNA of a nucleic acid of an organism. Then we have got the linear phase and then the plateau phase. The threshold of PCR has been set. This threshold is basically the distance from the baseline and the point from where the graph particularly start to rise. Now here you can see the different amplification curves. In real-time PCR, this curve should be S-shaped, which we commonly also known as sigmoidal shape. You can see the S-shape. If this doesn't come in a S-shape condition, we can say that it's contamination. You can see it over here, that these are very delayed peaks. So we can say that it's contamination or from obviously the crossover means. And we can also repeat this whole procedure or this whole process to confirm that either it's is it the contamination or it's the delayed expression of some disease. Now, let's talk about the applications of PCR. If we talk about the basic research in molecular ecology, epidemiology, and archaeology, we can find the applications of PCR. We can actually multiply or amplify the particular component which we want to do research on and see its stress on our environment. So it's related to molecular ecology. We can also see the expression of certain genetically modified organisms that are targeting our plant species. Similarly, in drug discovery, bioinformatics and genomics, PCR has its own application. We can actually design a whole drug within the facility of a computer, and then we have to run its PCR to confirm it. Also, we can identify site-directed mutations. Mutations are basically the alteration in the gene sequencing or gene genome of an organism, and cloning and genotyping is its more common application. However, if we talk about the applied research, genetic matching, which is forensics, and DNA fingerprinting, PCR is the most commonly used technique and is highly preferable because of its high sensitivity, specificity, and less prone towards the contamination. If we talk about the diagnosis, many diseases, let's just say hepatitis, HIV. Now, if we talk about of recent times, coronavirus are also detected on PCR. So here you can see that it's a widespread technique and this can't be ignored. The global trend of PCR has enormously increased, and according to the New York report, PR Newswire, PCR's market size is expected to reach $11.5 billion by 2024. In Asia Pacific areas, it is expected to witness the fastest similar period robust of CAGR of 9.2% and reached to $2.5 billion by 2022. So you can see that the PCR is offering many things to us, but this is us, the humans, who is ignoring this technique and who is not getting the most out of it. So here are some references from which we make these slides and which we use as a source to deliver what we want to you people. Thank you so much for your time. And it takes a lot of efforts to do these video lectures. So if you have any query or any question, you can ask in the thread below or comment section below. And as I always said, that we really need your support. Keep supporting us, keep liking us, and keep sharing us with your friends. Thank you so much. Till next time, Allah Hafiz.